Hi my lovely beanie people! How are you today? Today part 2 of the pricing and selling your jewelry line that I'm going to make. No, it's not a line. It's like a series of videos. That's the word I was looking for. So a series of videos. So if you didn't watch part 1 that was about pricing your jewelry, you can look it up. I will put a link down in the description box. If I make any mistakes or something that I forgot or something in this video, I will place that in the description box because YouTube doesn't allow annotations anymore. So I can't put like something on the video, so if there is something wrong or something that I wanted to add, it is always advice to, when you watch this video, look in the description box to see if I put anything there. But I will also put like links to videos and stuff like that in the description box. So what we're going to talk about today is about markets. So markets and flea markets and fairs and stuff like that. So Renaissance fairs and stuff like that. And how to set up for that. I think I'm going to split this video in 2 parts because I have a lot to talk about myself because I have been on markets. So I want to also share my experience with that. And I even have like a video because I made the local news with my newsstand with that I shared with a friend. So I wanted to show you that. It's just a short clip, but I'm going to see if I can do that next week, because I want to see if I can dig up some photos from that, because I believe my aunt took some photos and I need to address her about that, if she have those for me. So I'm going to do that, and I want to do that next week. This week I'm going to talk about the questions that my subscribers had. So I'm going to discuss those, and I think that I don't have enough time to talk about those in full and all the things that I have myself. So I'm going to do this in 2 parts, and I'm going to start with the questions that were here on YouTube. So I'm going to start with those, and then the Facebook questions, and then maybe if I have time left, things that I came up with myself. So this is the first question, and it is about how to package and transport your jewelry to flea markets. Well, you can do this in many ways, and you will really have to find like your thing to package them. But I can imagine that you find it hard to package them like one by one, especially if you have like a lot of jewelry. But it also depends on how you package them on your marketplace. So if you are a seller that goes to marketplace more often, and you can also package them up front and then lay them like that on your jewelry stand. So you have like those bags and those carts, you know what I mean, like the carts, the jewelry carts that you just can buy on eBay or stuff like that, that you can like use like a tag. And then you have like the bags that you can put around those, and then you can put a sticker on it or stuff like that, or just a piece of sticky tape, or it's not sticky tape, like scotch tape on it, and then you can carry them like that, but you can also sell them like that. So actually how you would sell like the regular jewelry in a normal store, you can do that. You can make up that yourself, like how you want to do that. What I did was I had crates, and what I did was I had foam, like thick foam in it. I'm going to grab a piece of foam to show you what kind of foam. Okay, found my foam. I wanted to get it from the attic, but there was also the kind of stuff like in front of it, so I couldn't reach it. Because I also have like an example, maybe I can show that the next time, of something I made that I hang my jewelry on. But it will also be next week in the video, because I showed that when I showed the video of my marketplace. So the one that the stand that I shared with my friend. Anyway, this kind of foam, so it's just the yellow foam. You can also get this in white or blue, and it's about this thick, so like finger thick, not very thick. I think this is 1 centimeter, so that would be like half an inch, about half an inch. That it doesn't really matter how thick. You can also use this, and I just yeah, this is the foam. Maybe you buy something on eBay or stuff, and they tape foam on this. They tape a foam on it. Oh, so. And I have this. I'm so chaotic today. This is the bubble foam that also works. What I did was like I had like a large pieces of the foam and I stuck my jewelry on that. So with pins, you can use like the regular pins that you use for sewing, but you can also use like safety pins or stuff like that. And I pinned it on that, and then I used like large one of that that is as large as my crate, and then I just stacked them up. So you would put like the jewelry on this, so like the necklace and stuff like that, but then a large piece, and you would pin it stuck. And you can just pin it like if you have a necklace on the top and then on the bottom. Of course, don't go through your beadwork, but around it. So if you have a larger beadwork, you can use larger safety pins. And then I stack them, so like all my earrings and stuff like that, and I put them like flat in my crate, and then I stack them on each other. And if you want to really protect them, although the this is very very soft already, I would like place the bubble stuff on this, so like that. So in that case, you know for sure that is one way to pack it. And I tried two ways, and I'm going to talk about both of them, because the one is more time consuming, so it totally depends on what kind of market you have. Like the first one I told you was with the first market I did, and that market was really I had the time to unpack and make a large, it was a very large stand, and it was very, you can take the time to make it pretty. So I really had the time to pack and unpack in both ways, if you know what I mean. So I really had the time for that. But this is time consuming, because once you are there on the market, you have to take all of your jewelry off and then place it out. So in that case, if you would make like the, what I said before, like the labels on it, and then with the sack on it, so the sack, it's not a sack, but it's like the plastic on top of it, so that you can just buy those sackets. I believe it's sackets in English. So you can buy those, and that would be a nice example to have it like quickly on and off your table. But that is if you like really do this more often, you want to do this more often, that might be a thing also to protect your jewelry. But this is a time consuming something, but people like to touch your jewelry. I know we don't like that, because we know all know that like if it gets touched a lot, and especially if people go on a market. I've been on a Christmas market, and that people like go around and eat, like we have oliebollen, that's like a very greasy pastry kind of thing, and you can put something in it or on top of it, stuff like that. Mostly we have like the normal olive bowl, and it has like sugar on top of it. What you have with the sugar is that like the greasy and the sugar, it is very bad for your jewelry. Of course, people aren't going to grab it like full with that, but the residue of that, you don't want that on your jewelry. So with those kinds of markets, it might be a good thing to pack it in plastic, that's the word also, like plastic. And then with the card, that could be something you could also very easily price that. Nevertheless, this was something that people really liked. I sold most on that market at that moment, because people could touch it, people could try it on. It looked more professional, because if you make like your own cards, or you let them make by a company, that would look very professional. But the normal jewelry cards look very cheap, but you can use those, but it will look cheaper. So it is just what you like and what kind of market. Are you on a high-end market, or are you on a flea market? It's also a very big difference. Anyway, so the packaging with like the cards and then the plastic, and with the foam, so in crates and then the foam, and then you have to like lay everything on your stand after that, after that you reach the market. There is one other way, and I'm going to show that in my next video, but I'm going to talk about it, and then in the next video I will show you how it looks like, because I can't go to the attic. I used like the photo frames, and I put I took the glass out and the cardboard that is behind that, so that you just have the frame. On that frame, and this is something that you might have seen before, I made with my stapler a piece of lace, a piece of lace on it. And you can also use like the stuff that you make a tutu of, so the petty skirt, like that stuff, you can also use that. And I made it on it with my stabler, because the frames I bought were very soft material. So I made that, and I did it in a color that I liked, so that is part of my team. And I also bought ribbons and stuff like that. So my whole, I can show you that in the video, that like my whole marketplace, so my stand has really the same color theme. And back then I used my old color, so the purple. And if you were here for a while, like the purple and the pink and then the green, that were my colors. And I used that, and then I did all my jewelry on that, so like with my earrings and stuff like that, and with the bobby pins you could do the necklaces, but I didn't brought not a lot of necklaces, so I just laid those on in the way that I did like with the foam. And then I hung them all on that, and then I packed them very carefully in like my bubble wrap. And then with my bubble wrap around that, I stacked them in an angle that the jewelry won't fall off, that they are straight but not too straight, because then if you like go in the car and they wiggle, you don't want them to fall off. So I placed them like that, that the weight of the jewelry was on the lace, but that it wasn't moving too much. Well, that worked, like for the transport of it, that worked. But what I tried, because that was in the theme of my marketplace, now was that I'm going to talk full about that market and why I didn't sell as much as the first one, all about it in the next video. But that really didn't work for me. I really had the feeling that like placing all the jewelry apart was better, but it was quicker. So it just depends on your style and stuff like that, because the basic idea with the earrings on that, I have seen that on many markets, and that really worked for those people. So it is just what you have. I didn't brought like a ton of jewelry that time also, because I didn't have the time to make a lot of things, so that might also be a part of it. And overall that market wasn't as a success, so not just with me or my friend, but like overall on the market wasn't as a success as it was a few years before, because before that it was all handmade, and now it was more like everything, and also like just retail stuff, and I don't know if I said it correctly, but I think you know what I mean. So very normal stuff also. Anyway, that was the three things that I came up with to package it. So the one with the plastic, you can also just throw that in a crate, or not throw, but in a crate, you can put it in a crate, and then with the plastic and the label on it, and then just lay it out like that. And if people touch it, they can't fit it in that way, or maybe you will allow them to take it out and then fit it. But anyway, that would be a hygienic, fast way, because you just can just grab your market stand up and then put it in a crate and then go. You can do it like the with the foam. So the foam and then the jewelry on top of it, and then stack it in a crate and then lay it all out on your marketplace. Or you can do it like with, I said, with the with this, the frame, so the photo frame, and then the lace on it, and then the jewelry on it. That would be a thing. Of course, there are many other things that you can do. Maybe if you know another, you are watching this and you know another way to do this, you can comment it down down below in the info box, not in the info box, no, in the comment box, sorry, the comment box, and maybe we can help each other with that. Anyway, up to the next question. So the second question is from the previous video, and I said there that if you have like an extra something, if you sell it for a little bit extra, that you have an extra something to sell with that. So for example, if the market price is 25, but you sell it at 30, what are you doing extra for those for the €5 or $5? And a question I got from that is that I'm going to just read out loud that you understand the question. I offer free repairs of my jewelry if it should break. But I have some customers who are extremely hard on jewelry and are constantly breaking them. How often should I repair the pieces, especially since the breakage is not due to workmanship? Or should I just suck it up and keep fixing it for free? Well, that is actually a good question, and I doubted it put this with Etsy or with this series, but I think it is good because with this series, as I have seen people also offer this on markets. And if you maybe have like a Facebook group or something, or Facebook page, and you have like something like that selling, or maybe even a website, and you are on a market, I think that this is something that you would also encounter on a market, because maybe someone is of a local and they come to visit you because something breaks. Anyway, what I think about that, there are people, just period, that are rough with their jewelry. I know from experience that people can be, they don't know the delicacy of the bracelet. So we know that it is delicate parts, and you don't have to keep breaking them necessarily, because you can just be careful with it and then it will be okay. So maybe wear it to an occasion and stuff like that. Well, I wouldn't keep repairing them for free, depending on what it is. I would offer like, if it breaks, I repair it for free. And you can't say like, that's just for the first time, because that would throw people off. But you could say like, free repairs if there is anything wrong within that and that many months. That's what I did. So for example, or weeks, mostly it's 6 weeks. So for example, someone buys a necklace with you and they break it, and within those next 6 weeks they break it twice, fix it twice, but with after those 6 weeks they can go to you for repairing, but you can always say like, and you should not put that in the same context. So you should not say like, oh, within 6 weeks I will make it for free, and if you break it after that, I will fix it for that. Make it a separate thing. So let's say you get 6 weeks to come back to me, and I will repair it for free, no matter what it is. Maybe you could also, but that is something you could say like, maybe for the material. So for example, you make a Tila bracelet, and someone gets stuck on the door, and they shatter it somehow. You should pay like the material cost, like not hey, you don't have to pay for the labor, but you would have to pay for the jewelry parts. Because if I go to the jewelry store, so the real, like with the sterling silver, and I go to that and I buy there a ring, like for example this one, I'm just showing you this one, for example, I would buy this heart ring, and there's a stone in this. I can go to them and say, this ring is broken. Maybe they will fix it for free. If I have the stone and they just have to place the stone in because it falls in the guarantee. I don't know, it's the, you know what I mean, like that you get 6 weeks or longer or shorter of that. But if I don't have the stone, it might be that I have to pay for the stone. Now with the jewelry store, we would find that very normal. But with like handmade and stuff, they actually think that you have to do it for free. Don't do it for free. If they lose Tila beads, and the Tila beads are, let's say, 20 cents a piece, maybe we can take Ava beads, because we know what those cost. I believe that the Ava beads are 45 cents a piece, and they break like six of them. You should not have to pay for that. So ask something for that, or they have to bring like all the jewelry pieces intact to you. In that case, you could just fix it for free and not charge your thread or something like that, because maybe that's 20 cents and that will maybe be more customer friendly. But if they really lose a bigger part and stuff like that, I would ask something for that. Anyway, If you've done that, like 6 weeks, and then place it separate. So say, oh, when there's something wrong with your jewelry, I will fix it. Fix it within six, or not within 6 weeks. I will fix it for you for free if you send it back to me within 6 weeks, or so within the time span from starting that you bought it and stuff like that. And I know I hope I make this that clear. That sometimes my Dutch and my English language is hard to explain with each other. But what I trying to say is that you should make a time span for that, and then offer somewhere else on your page or something, or on your market stand, like fix jewelry for that and that amount. Now you can also get people that just want something fixed with you. I always advise those people to go back to the one that they sold it from, bought it from. But if they can't, you can always offer that repair and then see like what your costs are. You can also say like repairs cost that and that, or repairs from to something like that, and make it something like that, or I do repairs, show me your jewelry, ask it for the price, something like that. Because there will be people that bought something that want to have it fixed, or maybe they have like an old necklace. I once fixed a necklace for someone that that someone got it from their grandma, and that grandma was also beading, and she didn't know how to fix it, and it was like I don't know, it's like African beading, so with the like small seed beads and stuff like that. Now it was very simple because it was like crochet on the top, so I got it out and then I did it again and made it, and then just attached the clasp on it, so it was not very hard. But the person was very happy with that because they could finally wear the necklace that they got from the granny again. So that might be something that you should have in mind. And if you don't want that, it's also okay. Like repairs of my own things only, that's also okay. But make it something that looks good. So don't make it something that people think, oh, I don't want that, or oh, is it going to break within 6 weeks, or is it going to break more often? Like that, you don't want to have such a text. So I hope that was clear, and I will go to the next question now. And if you have any more questions about this, please ask. The next question is how to set up your table. Now this is something that isn't talked about in one time, because you have many ways to set up your table. It is totally different how you set up your table in winter than in summer, because you also have like to work out like the weather and stuff like that, because it's not as easy as you go to the market and ta-da. But it is like you have to know your weather conditions and what you should also like what you should wear yourself and stuff like that, and what kind of jewelry goes with that. So I'm going to talk to you about that in the next video also, but I'm going to make it small for now. So just the basic setup for your table, it totally depends on what you sell. You can do this in many kinds of ways. What I really like are, I'm just going to give you a few examples, and I hope to have some photos of that for the next video, or at least some examples better explained. So if you have like a tablecloth, so a very, very large one, I personally like black velvet or stuff like that for it. But you can also use like a normal color, a lighter color, so I used gray kind of blue gray kind of velvet also. That is very nice for winter. Black can be very harsh, but it can also look very classy. You can also use red or green or stuff like that. It is just what you like, but I like velvet the best. But if you have another kind of cloth, so maybe you are I'm going to show you an example. Come on, go pause. Sorry for that. maybe like this. So this is a bag, but you can see this is like the very hard stuff. Some really like that, and they have like urban jewelry or maybe different kind of jewelry, and that would be very nice, but I think very expensive also, but very nice to put on it also. White, of course, you can also use white. So a tablecloth, you will need that. And as I said, I'm going to more in depth about this question the next time, because I have a lot of things to tell about that, because I have a lot of ideas for that. But also things that I noticed myself that I need to do or not do again, stuff like that. What also can be very nice is like boxes underneath the tablecloth. So if you buy a few meters extra all around so that you can put something under it. So what I like about that is that you have like... you can make different kinds of layers on your table, because the table itself is just super flat. So if you make like on one corner and the other corner, you put like boxes underneath it, and then you strike like the cloth so that you have it like in a shape. You can also put something round, maybe you have like very large pillows or stuff like that round on it, and then set something against that. So maybe if you like use the rack with the photo frame, and then you put your jewelry on that, so maybe your earrings or stuff like that. You can also put it against that, but in that way you create like some layers in it. Of course you can go flat, but I like the layers myself because it looks more professional, but it's also very easy for yourself, especially if you use like boxes. If like most of the stands are 4 meters, at least that's here. I don't know how many how long that is in English, but 4 meters, so that's 400 centimeters. And if you have to do that on your own, that can be very large. So if you want to don't have like tons of jewelry, maybe you have to like you have to make your stand smaller. Well, you can do that with the boxes underneath the tablecloth also, that you can take it in a little bit, and then maybe put some notes on it. So like I used like a photo frame, and I framed like my price list or something like that, or that I for Christmas I did like that I package things, and I'm going to talk about that in the next video also. And I put that on it, and that looked very nice. It gave like a little bit of decrease of the space of my, it gave a little bit of decrease, so that I don't have to space out my jewelry as much as I did. And if you have like larger jewelry, so more jewelry, you can still make that. So I have a large amount of jewelry, but you can still make that. But the higher up is something that I really like. So that is something that you could do with your stand. And I'm going to talk about it more in detail in the next video. As I have a lot about to tell about it, but it's also fun to show you like the piece I have, like the piece of tape I have from the time that I made the local news with that. So I'm going to show you that next time, and I'm going to your next question. So the next question, and that is in the same question, and I'm going to read it out loud. Do you try to have multiples of some easier to lower cost items, or do you try to stick to one of a kind or higher priced items? Well, that's actually a good question. That all the questions are good, but this is actually a good question, because it totally depends on I can see why beaders think that, like, oh, what am I going to do? So as I said in the last video, you can do it mixed, so you can integrate one with the other. But it also totally depends on what kind of market you're going to do. Are you going to a high-end market? Then I would go for your high-end jewelry, and I wouldn't put too much low cost, low material, low something on your market or your stand, sorry. But it can really spike sales. So for example, let's say that you make High-end jewelry. Some things that really get people's attention is sparkle. You have like the rondelles, and if you have like the bracelets of that, this is not rondelle, but the bracelet, I don't know if I have an example of that. I don't think so at this moment. But you know the rondelles, the shiny rondelles. If you place it in eBay, you can just see the china glass. It's very cheap, especially what is in now, at least it's in my country, it's very much in. It's like the 3x4 millimeter rondelles, and then small bracelets of that, and then small bracelets together, and they sell for like, I believe they are 3-4 like 8 euros or stuff like that. It is very easy to make, it is fast to make, and then you can put like a bale of stuff on it, and it's very cute. But that is low cost, but it can spike sales and it still looks fancy. So if you would go for like low cost materials and stuff like that, I would do the same as I said in my last video. Buy fake Swarovski, not plastic, but just glass. And then make like Swarovski things with those without all the expensive beads. So more with like the seed beads and stuff. Because you can still use Miyuki for the tight beadings, so to say. But in you can make like a bracelet as those stones are very cheap, maybe for $2-3 and then sell it for a low high end price. That's the one. So a low high end price. So for example, if I made it with a real Swarovski, it would be 45 euros, and now you can maybe sell it for 10 or for 15, just depending on how much time you spend on it and what the materials cost you. So that might be an idea. So on the other end, if you go to like a flea market, please make like as much as cheaper stuff as you can, because people will buy that. You can also, what I personally like even better than that, is that you can make some stuff that you really like, that you like yourself, or maybe you saw before, and then first see like the 2 or 3 flea markets, like what sells, what doesn't sell, what are people grabbing. That is also very important. What are people grabbing? They think, oh, that's cute, but maybe the price is not right, or maybe the color is off or something like that, and they put it back. And mostly the same kind of pieces are grabbed and then laying back again. So that can be your price, it can be your color. Mostly if people pick it up, it is not your color, but it can be that they have not enough choices. And that is something to watch. Maybe if there is a piece that is grabbed many times, you can make more of those in more colors and then put a different price on it. It can be that it needs to be higher, it can be that it needs to be lower. But don't ask your customers, but just you need to get a feeling of that. Of course, you can ask your customers like, why are you not buying this? But that is too direct in my opinion. And maybe you have a marketplace that is something like that. You can also see maybe that other people are making this also, and that is why you are having too high or too low price or something like that. If it is too low and many people may make it, mostly you will be the one that gets the sale. Anyway, that is something that you need to do, like look at what kind of market you have, and then see for yourself if you want to make it high-end or low-end, or maybe a mix of that, but high-end mostly then, and then a little bit of low-end to spike your sales. Keep that in balance. So I hope this was clear. If you have any other questions for me about that, or maybe about anything else of this, so please ask me. And I'm going to see if I have more questions. I didn't count them, sorry. Yes, I had one last question, and the next one that I'm not going to answer is about Etsy. So everything about Etsy, I'm going to talk about that in a different series, and I'm absolutely going to talk about that in depth also. Maybe even to the point that I can make you show you how to set up an Etsy store. But just to be sure about that, I don't know yet like how to turn my camera so the like on You have like a program that you can like set up the things with your computer, and I really have to see that. So the Etsy questions are going to go to the next time, but I need to figure out how to show you from my computer how I do this without filming my computer directly, if that makes sense. Anyway, the last question is about tags. I'm just going to read out the question out loud. Tags and displays are areas I'm concerned with, since I want to show my work in a flattering manner and with a clear indication of the price. I have seen people post their prices on signs, and people always look at tags or ask the prices. Yes, that's actually something that I have not experienced myself. But I can imagine that you have that experience, because it totally depends on how you place that. If you have like a clear section, so for example, you have three cloths on your stand. So you have a black one, I'm just naming something, a black one, a white one, and a red one. And you're placing like a card very clearly in the middle of the red one. The jewelry on the red cloth is 10 euros, and then the jewelry on the white cloth, white cloth is 50 euros, and then the ones on the black cloth are 25 euros. That works. What doesn't work is like trying to categorize like very, very much different prices. So for example, if you have like 750, 550, and then 15, and then 25, and maybe even 50, something like that, that will not work. So then in that case, labeling is better. It is not flattering, but you have so many cute cards. You can check out eBay. You have like the craft card cards. You have like with a golden edge on it. You have like the simple white cards. You have all kinds of super cute cards. You even can let them make by a company. You can have like red ones or pink ones and stuff like that. So if you have like me, I had like pink and then purple and green. So maybe one of those colors or all the colors or stuff like that. You can also play with that. Like if you have like variations in stuff. Sorry for that. I'm just scratching myself. for like variations that you have like a different color for all the variations, just what you like. But that would be something that I would consider. Actually, it doesn't have to be a problem, but I can think, I can understand that you think that that the price cards are not flattering, but actually they can be, because when I go on a market and I see like the 25 euros or 10 euros or 50 euros, that is very markety, like cheaper markety to me, because those are the people that go on the market that sell often. And yes, that can work depending on the jewelry. It can also look very cheap. I made a huge mistake the last time that I was in a market to have those kinds of things on it, because it made it look cheaper. If you have like a price tag on every piece of jewelry, they instantly know. If you can place that on yourself, like if you go to a market and you see all the price tags on it, you instantly know that you're going to pay more at this marketplace than on something that is shouts like 10 euro, 50 euros, and like that. So I would not see this as not flattering. I would totally do that actually, but take cute cards, so search your way and add something to your price of the jewelry, like 20 cents extra for the cards, but add cute cards and then make it work in that way. So that was the last question, and I'm going to see now how much time I have been filming, and if I have time left, I'm going to answer some other questions that I said I would be answering, but I don't know if I can do that in one video. So I I believe I have like 5 more minutes, but I'm going to do it like this. I'm going to tell you what I'm going to talk about next with the market, and I have like many examples. If you have other questions for this video, please tell me. I can always make a third part for this video so that we have like the whole package of what you need to know when you go to a market. And I am answering subscriber questions first, because I think always like if one asks, maybe more people wanted to know that question also. So please, if you have any questions for me left, I'm going to say what I'm going to talk about next. So the next things I'm going to talk about is what do you bring to the market? So are you going to the market like with extra things and stuff like that? I'm just going to talk about what you need to know, like chains and stuff you need to bring that. And how to act and not to act on the market. That might sound very weird, but we all have been to a market that a market stand holder is like sitting on a chair and smoking and stuff like that, and not paying attention to the customers, or maybe having like a nasty attitude before they, if people don't buy something like that and stuff like that. So I want to talk about that, because I think that is very important. And what kind of markets are right for jewelry? Also a very important one. Of course, in a previous video I talked about some markets that you can do for jewelry, but not all markets are right for jewelry. So for example, it is also depending like on what kind of jewelry you make, because if you make high-end jewelry, you can go to the flea market, you can go to a vintage market. If it's not vintage, but maybe you have some vintage piece or vintage inspired or stuff like that. It also depends on the rules of the vintage market, because if they go solely for vintage, then maybe not. But if you make like the cabochon beaded things with like the simple necklace, that is something that was worn back in the day, so maybe you can make new vintage of that, if you understand what I mean. Anyway, I'm going to talk to you about that the next time also. And how to pack your jewelry, that is what we already discussed. But I'm going to show you like my frame, if I can find it, And I'm going to show you like how I did that with my market, so with my stand on the market, because I went to a Christmas fair, so I went in Dickens style and stuff like that. So maybe you like that, I don't know how you guys are going to react to that, but okay. Take notes for the next market, very important. If you have had done a market and you have been on the market, you have to take notes not only from the market itself, but also like what have you learned, what have you experienced and stuff like that. Make like a little bit of a notebook for that, so that you know what you missed or what you have to do extra next time and stuff like that. But also tips and tricks that you might have gotten from other market stand holders. And very important, and not to forget, how to deal with rude customers. I have a story that I have told like in the beginning of when I made videos, that I had a very, very rude, it wasn't even a customer, but just a rude person. And also like you have a rude, you also have rude stand holders. So I'm going to talk to you about that the next time, so that we can really discuss that in that I can really give you like the full package. If you have anything to add to that, please let me know. I don't know if I can make it that in one video, if you also have extra questions, but I will do my best to put it in as much in one video as I can. Nevertheless, the next time we're going to talk about Etsy also. So the next time will be about markets, and then we are also going to talk about Etsy. But I really want to take my time for that, because I don't want to be quick with it and then maybe not have answered your questions in full. But I think that would be very important to know, because very many people are very curious at Etsy, like what is it, what can I do there, and how is it going and stuff like that. And I have like a lot of things to tell you about that. So I hope this video is clear. If you have any questions about marketplaces, please let me know. If I missed something, or maybe you're not agreeing with something, like let me know. And if you want to see this video the next time also, so these kind of videos, please give me a thumbs up. And you can thumb me down if you don't like these kind of videos. That's also okay. But I would really like to hear what you think of this video. I'll see you the next time, and we're going to talk about marketplaces the next time. And I hope that you will like it. Have a nice day. Bye.